Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nasta'hdihi wa nasta'afiruh. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. من يهده الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Dear brothers and sisters, our Sahabi for today, and as you know, we are in talking about stories from the lives of Sahaba al-Kiram, the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we have been doing so for the last probably 6 months. And our Sahabi for today is Abu Ubaida Amer ibn al-Jarrah Alfihri radiyallahu anhu. Abu Ubaida is one of those cream of the la creme. He is really very unique. He's in the caliber of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhum. It is enough to mention that he was one of the 10 who received the glad tiding in their lives to be in heaven. As you know, there is a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In one occasion, he had stated that Abu Bakr fil Jannah, in heaven, is destined to be in heaven. Umar ibn al-Khattab fil Jannah. Uthman ibn Affan fil Jannah. Ali ibn Abi Talib fil Jannah. Abdurrahman ibn Auf fil Jannah. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas fil Jannah. الزبير ابن العوام في الجنة طلحة ابن عبيد الله في الجنة عامر أبو عبيدة عامر ابن الجراح في الجنة and سعيد ابن زيد في الجنة. Those were the first believers, the first who came to the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم when he declared his prophecy, to accept his message, to accept his prophethood without hesitation. As a matter of fact, he became Muslim the following day after Abu Bakr as-Siddiq accepted Islam. And you know, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was the first Muslim among the men. Khadija bint Khuwaylid was the first Muslima at all. I mean, across, because she was the wife of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she was the first woman who became Muslim, and the first male and female person to become Muslim. And Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu an, as a young boy, 8 years of age, he was the first child who became Muslim. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, the following day, he did not waste any time after he became Muslim. He started himself becoming a messenger of Islam. And he talked to his friends, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, Uthman ibn Affan, Uthman ibn Maz'um, and Abu Salama ibn Abdi Asad, and Al-Arqam ibn Abi Al-Arqam. And he brought 5 of them to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and telling him that they are willing to accept Islam. So you can imagine the rewards of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, that all of those who he brought them to Islam, of course the hidayah comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he was instrumental in bringing these five great men to become Muslim. You imagine the dividends he would receive from all their good deeds in their lives and after whatever they have left of sadaqah jariyah. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq gets a dividend from all of their good deeds, radiyallahu anhu. So Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah became Muslim the following day after Abu Bakr as-Siddiq became Muslim. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was the instrument to introduce him to Islam. He did not waste any time, and this is a lesson for us. You are a Muslim by your character. We don't want talks. By your character of honesty and love of charity and good deeds and being helpful, being selfless, you can invite and influence people around you. People are very thirsty to love and compassion and a gentle, kind hand. And you would be amazed how many people would accept your way or the message, the way of your deen and so on. And we study the stories of the life of the companions because they were the practical or application of the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They are historic figures, and we can learn from them. He was 25 years of age, young man, and he was from Quraysh, Bani Fihr. They are the last of the butun, or the clans, or the branches of Quraysh. And he was considered of, if there is anything, like a pure Arab. He's like from the heart of the land. You know, here in America, when you want to talk about, you know, the backbone of the Americans, you go to the heart of the land, the deep west or the middle west. So he was one of those Arabs who are in a way very full of pride and prestige of being the backbone of Arabia. I'm mentioning this because there's a lesson we will learn from that very soon. So he became Muslim. He suffered what all the Muslims suffered in the Mecca period of abuse, torture, verbal abuse, physical abuse, and so on. And he was one of who were given permission to make hijrah to Al-Habasha, Abyssin, or Ethiopia, the second hijrah. So Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah was of those who made the migration to Habasha to escape the torture and the abuses of Quraysh. And we know that he came back later, and he made another hijrah from Mecca to Medina when the Muslims given the permission to migrate from Mecca to Medina, and that is in the 13th year of the Ba'tha. After 13 years in Mecca, the Muslim given permission to go to Medina. So Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah is called Sahib al-Hijratayn. And these are certificates, those are medals in his resume, you know, of his greatness. So he was of the first who became Muslims. When the Muslims, you were able to count them on one hand, on the fingers of one hand. So he was an early Muslim. And that is before the Muslim entered the house of, or the club of Al-Arqam ibn Abi Al-Arqam Al-Makhzumi. He was very young. He was one of the 10 who received the glad tiding to be in heaven. And he was Sahibul Hijratayn. And according to Imam al-Nawawi in his book, Tahdhibul Asma, and it is a two-volume book. Imam Nawawi has his own also book, like Al-Isaba and like Usud al-Ghaba, which talks about the Sahaba al-Kiram. Ironically, that when I came to the States close to 40 years ago, I brought with me a copy of the Quran, and I brought with me the book Riyad al-Salihin, which the author is also Imam al-Nawawi, and I brought with me the book Tahdhib al-Asma, which I have it till now. Imam al-Nawawi, his books amazingly had the blessing being so righteous in life, and you read the story or the life of Imam Nawawi, made his books amazingly widespread, and all of this of the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in book Tahdhib al-Asma, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made ikha, he made a brotherhood ties between Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah, the pure Arab from Bani Fihr, with whom? With Bilal ibn Rabah. All of you, you know, Bilal was the slave, the son of a slave in the Jahiliyyah, and probably nowadays, who has nothing and been abused, so he's in the lowest level of our classification to the greatness of people. He has nothing. His father, Rabah, been beaten up by Umayyah ibn Khalaf, and Bilal himself been beaten up by Umayyah and his brother Ubay and his son Safwan. And they've been, you know, the story about Bilal, how much he was tortured. The same thing, his mother, Hamama, was tortured to death. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu anh, freed Bilal and his mother, Hamama. He bought them from Umayyah. When he asked Umayyah, stop this torture, have fear of Allah. He told him, you have any feeling towards them? You buy them. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq bought them. And immediately he set him free. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he heard that, he was so happy, and he asked Abu Bakr as-Siddiq to be his partner in this deal, to pay 50-50. But Abu Bakr as-Siddiq refused. He said, no, I want to take it. So it is so beautiful. Bilal ibn Rabah, the black, the African, the Ethiopian, who was slave, he was abused, he had nothing. His father is a slave, his mother is a maid. Immediately, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam make him a brother of Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah. What does that mean? They became buddies in society, in their work, in their business, in their eating, in their living, and so on. A kind of adoption. And the same thing, another Sahabi give him his sister as a wife to Bilal ibn Rabah, another great pure Arab from Bani Zuhra, Abdurrahman ibn Auf. This is the equality of Islam, who from day number one said, nobody better than nobody, no black better than white, no white better than black. All of us are from the same family, came from Adam and Eve. And the best among you, who is the best in his action and deed and righteousness and taqwa and benefit to humanity. Believe me, if any other group on planet Earth, other religion, they have this, what happened 1,400 years of these principles, core values, if they had it at that time, they would make big deal out of it, and they spread it right and left and so on. These are jewels which nowadays all mankind adopted, all the way to United Nations. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, the illiterate, the prophet, he came with those ideals, not to be in philosophy books on the shelves, like utopia, things impossible to do, but it is good, it looks good. No, it was practiced. And the Sahaba al-Kiram were in tens of thousands. They were the material proof for the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We see it on the ground. We see it in life, in real life. So Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah radiallahu anh, after the hijrah, he became a shadow of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What we mean by that, he witnessed all the events, the daily events, with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he was a close companion, like Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, like Umar ibn al-Khattab, like Uthman ibn Affan, like Ali ibn Abi Talib. And he attended all the events in Medina from Badr all the way to Hajjat al-Wada'. And as we know, the first incident happened in Badr in the second year of the Hijrah. And we know the war was avoidable, but the arrogance of Abu Jahl, who vowed to amass a big army in their standard, it was like 1,000 soldiers with camels and horses, and they vowed to go and crush the few hundred Muslims. And the Muslims had no choice but to defend themselves. And we know the story of Badr, the incident of Badr, where the Muslims were close to 314 companions. And the battle was very fierce, and we know that the end result was in the favor of the Muslims. And during that battle, the father of, or before the battle, the father of Abu Ubaida, his name is Abdullah. We don't see Abdullah in the name of Abu Ubaida because this happens a lot of times where the name of the father is dropped, where the name of the grandfather is mentioned. So Abu Ubaida, his full name is Abu Ubaida Amer ibn Abdullah ibn al-Jarrah al-Fihri. Abdullah was a mushrik, and he was irated for his son to become a Muslim. And he did all what he can do to persuade him to become a kafir, mushrik, to worship the idols. And he did what he can do of harassing him, torturing him, abusing him, till obliged him to make the hijrah to Habash. And then when he came back and make hijrah to Medina, his father was obsessed in settling this score with his son. And he vowed to kill him. And when Badr came, he went to the market and he bought the best of the swords and the best of the spears and the best of the ammunition of that time. And he went to Badr with one single objective in his mind. He has no interest in fighting the Muslims or fighting Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His main mission was to kill his son, Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah. And in the narration, he took those sharp equipment, and I don't know if he poisoned the sword or not, but he went there and he was trying to spot his son. And Abu Ubaida radiallahu anh, he was a strong man. He was very tall, like 6'6", very slim, very muscular, very good looking. As a matter of fact, we know that Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu anh, he is describing the quality of Abu Ubaida, the physical or the physique of Abu Ubaida, Amr ibn Jarrah. He was very good looking and very strong. And in the Battle of Badr, he was a hero. Reminds me of the Greek, you know, the Trojan Wars and all those figures of Paris and Hector and Achilles and so on. So he was this quality of a fighter. And he saw his father and he read his mind and he knew from the back that he vowed to kill him. Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah, he knows the Islamic teaching about your parents who are not Muslim. you take good care of them, you love them, you attend to their needs, you let them live in peace and live in prosperity and in no need, and you satisfy all their worldly needs and so on. But وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا. If they tell you, they want to mess up the compass of your brain, the way of your life, which is based on honesty and dedication to truth and justice and equality and so on, you don't listen to them. That's the extent of it. You don't abuse your mushrik parents. You don't hurt them. You don't do anything bad to them. But you don't align yourself with them, because your way in life is very clear. It's the way of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the way of God and the way of the message, the way of the principles, the way of the law and so on. You abide by the law. If your parents tell you to go and steal, you don't obey them. You love them, respect them, you take care of them, but you don't obey them when it comes to the rules and laws and principles and the moral values and virtues. So if your parents do tell you not to be virtuous, you don't obey them. And you do that with full respect and love to them. But it stops here. And this is what happened. Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah, he knows this is his father, and he knows what the father, obligation on you as the son and so on. So he tried all during the battle to avoid him. But that man who was stalking his son was able to corner him in a place where he separated him from the battlefield and from his friends, and face to face raised his brand new equipment to kill him. And here Abu Ubaida had no choice. And when he faced the situation, which is, has no other solution but to defend himself, either to be killed or to kill his father. Not to kill his father, to kill the stubbornness and the shirk inside his father. It's unfortunate it was inside that body. So he faced him when his father wanted to kill him. He killed him. He killed his father. We know the ayat which revealed in this behalf that, you know, you have to align yourself with God and his messenger and Islam. Though it's the same ayat tells you to take good care of your parents. And I hate when I see somebody citing this story when they say, oh, he loved Muhammad, he killed his father. No, you love Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you don't need to kill your father, you know, if he's a mushrik or kafir. Abu Ubaida killed his father in self-defense. And this is a human right. I mean, if anyone, not father, any person who come to kill you, it's your right to defend yourself. So this is what happened in the Battle of Badr. In Uhud, Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah was the same way, was a strong man who did everything to defend the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to defend the Muslims, to defend Islam against Quraysh, who also was threefold more than the Muslims. And we know what happened, that Abu Amir al-Fasiq, he did a trap. He dug a hole and covered it with wood and so on. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam fell to his side, and he bled. He broke some ribs. The armor of two pieces of his armor went through his face and severed the facial artery. And this artery is, if you see how it bleeds, it's very scary. And we know the Fatima radiallahu anha and Aisha radiallahu anha, they tried hard to stop the bleeding. And we know that at that time, a group of Quraysh on horses led by Ibn Qim'a, they tried to kill the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he was at that moment alone in front of like 20, 30 of Quraysh on horses. And he was wounded. He was on his side in the hole, shallow place, and he was very weak. He was bleeding profusely. And nobody was between the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Quraysh, and Ibn Qim'ah, who vowed to kill Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was screaming, "Tell me where is Muhammad? La najawtu in najah." And we know that a single woman stood between him and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Musayba bint Ka'b al-Maziniyah. She did a heroic role in the after seven of the children from Al-Ansar were killed defending Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the last one of them, Yazid ibn Sakan, was in the last of his breath, he pulled himself and put his face on the feet of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he gave up his soul. And we know at that moment the Muslims, after they came to their senses, after the shock which was created and the chaos which was created with the maneuvering of Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu and Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl, when they surrounded the Muslim from the back and they started the chaos there. We know that several of the companions rushed to the rescue of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially Talha ibn Ubaidillah, who at-Tamimi, who did shield the Prophet with his body. He put himself above the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and hundreds of arrows landed on his back. As a matter of fact, one of the arrows hit his sciatic nerve, and he became paralyzed in the leg, or very limping on the side. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas came to the rescue, and Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas was a sharp shooter on the archer. He was an archer, and we know that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was encouraging him when he told him, "Irmi fidaka abi wa ummi." He did not say that to any other companions but Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, where he made his father and mother. It's a kind of dua to shoot. And we know that Sa'd, in 5 minutes, he used 1,000 arrows against the mushriks, against the horses who were crushing them. And the horses also became panicky and scared, and they ran away. At that time, we see Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu coming like an arrow, a speed of light, coming to the rescue, and Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah. And they reached the situation, and they saw the two metal pieces severing the artery here and bleeding very hard. And here, Abu Bakr wanted to move it out, but Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah begged him to let him do this, because it needs something very delicate like a tweezer to get it out. And the tweezer at that time was the teeth of Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah. So he came close to the cheek of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. With his front teeth, he bit on the pieces of metal and pulled it out gently. And he lost four of his teeth with this maneuver. So he became ahtam. He was good looking, and the companions telling us that after he lost those four teeth, he became more beautiful. So, of course, the bleeding was stopped. I said that Fatima radiallahu anha burned straws and with the ashes, which is with when you burn something, you make it sterile. The ashes were applied to the wound, and with the pressure and so on, the bleeding eventually stopped. And we know that Talha ibn Ubaidillah carried the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they went up to the mountain to higher ground. So Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah was next to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in all the incidents like Uhud and Al-Khandaq. And we see him now in the incident of Al-Hudaybiyah, Sulh Al-Hudaybiyah, the peace treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah. You know, from if you borrow from nowadays media and the pollsters and the all these polls, it's obvious that the Muslims are gaining by number, by followers, by ground, by everything, and it's just a matter of time. And in Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, we see the mushriks who were fragmented, and they were much weaker, but they have custody of Mecca and the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's a family of the al-Muhajireen, all of them. And they came to dictate. And here Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes with 10,000 strong men, Muhajireen and Ansar, up in arms. The adrenaline was pumping, and they are going there to fight because Quraysh, you know, were unjust and caused a lot of hardship to. At any rate, in Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam agreed for conditions which is not in the interest of the Muslims. Like, if you become a Muslim from Quraysh, they return you back to your family. But if somebody from the Muslims become, let's say, kafir or from mushrikeen, it's okay. And many other, and here the Muslims were irated. What is this? Is this a victory? And we know, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا, it doesn't talk about Fatah Mecca, it talk about Salah al-Hudaybiyah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you this is a victory. Victory is, though the articles of the agreement were not in the favor of the Muslims. And here, the Sahaba were kind of anti-climaxy. They were upset, shocked, did not understand what's going on, and they argued about this. And the one who argued the most was Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu. And of course, this incident, Umar ibn al-Khattab continued to remember the rest of his life, and he tells us he spent so much money in freeing slaves, in giving charity, in making salah, in making siyam for the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he questioned the decision of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And here, Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he was arguing about this, how come? We are strong, we are right, we are, you know, et cetera, et cetera. How can we give them those? Here, Abu Ubaida Amer ibn Jarrah, just to know what caliber. You know, Umar ibn al-Khattab is a giant. He can scare, you know, not the humans, he can scare the jinn themselves. You know, when they see him walking on one side, they jump on the other side. At any rate, here we see Abu Ubaida Amer ibn Jarrah, who was very gentle. He was a gentle giant, very humble, down to earth, modest. You see him in serious issues, becomes a lion. And here, Umar ibn Abu Ubaida answered Umar ibn al-Khattab in very strong language, which made him calm down and sit down and seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the shaitan ar-rajim. And he told him in very strong word, أَلَا تَسْمَعْ يَبْنَ الْخَطَّابِ, when he does not call him Umar or Aba Abdullah, it means a warning. يَبْنَ الْخَطَّابِ, أَلَا تَسْمَعْ يَبْنَ الْخَطَّابِ, رَسُولُ اللَّهِ يَقُولُ مَا يَقُولُ, نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. And Umar ibn al-Khattab sat down and said, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ, and he calmed down. And we know that Sulh al-Hudaybiyah was the beginning of end for Quraysh, and it was a victory for the Muslims, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told them. And the ayat of the Quran supported that. And we know the role of Umm Salama radiallahu anha. She was a very strong lady, and she gave her input and told the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just go and do what you're supposed to do, and they will follow you. And this is what happened. He cut his hair, and he made slaughter the Qurbani and so on, and the Muslims followed him, and the crisis was diffused. Abu Ubaida Amer ibn Jarrah radiallahu an was given the title of Amin al-Ummah. This is the title given to him by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What happened, two stories from the Yemen. One of them, the Christian of Najran, they had big fight between two groups, two tribes about money, and they did not find a fair person to arbitrate or intermediate. So they came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him to send a person with them so they will listen to their problem and judge among them. So Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah was that man, and we will tell the detail about this story. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu an, in describing Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah, he tells us three people of Quraysh who were the most beautiful in their faces and physique, and the best in their moral conduct. ثلاثة من قريش أصبح الناس وجوها وأحسنها أخلاقا وأثبتها حياء. And the most modest, حياء, you know, modesty or down to earth. إن حدثوك لم يكذبوك. When they talk to you, they don't lie at you. وإن حدثتهم لم يكذبوك. And when you tell them something, they do not question your authenticity or your honesty. Abu Bakr wa Uthman wa Abu Ubaida Amir ibn Jarrah. So those are in a class. You know, all the Sahaba share with them this, but this is like the perfect 10. So Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah was given the title of Amin al-Ummah. So when this delegation of Nasara Najran came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him for an arbitrator or a judge to solve the problem, otherwise a war will erupt, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, come back in the evening. I will send with you Al-Qawiy Al-Amin, the strong, the trustworthy. And the one who is telling us the story is none but Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. So imagine this title, Al-Qawiy Al-Amin. This is a medal, it's a golden medal of honor. If you can get it, don't spare any efforts to have it. You know, it goes in history and all the way to the Day of Judgment. And Umar ibn al-Khattab telling us this incident happened at Zuhr prayer. And he is telling us he never cared about being emir or being, you know, sent as the leader. But in that incident, he loved for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to pick him up, not for anything but to gain that title, Al-Qawiy Al-Amin. So when it was the Salah, he came the first man to the masjid. And he stood up in a vantage point, so Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would see him in his face. So if he forgot him, you know, no way to forget him. He's there to remind him that I'm here, you know. So when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam finished the Salat al-Zuhr and turned his back to, turned his face towards the Musallin, he started looking right and left like he's trying to spot one person. And here Umar al-Khattab is telling us, فَجَعَلْتُ أَتَطَاوَلُ لَهُ الْيَرَانِ. He started, you know, making some, to bring his attention that I'm here. فَجَعَلْتُ أَتَطَاوَلُ لَهُ الْيَرَانِ. فَلَمْ يَزَلْ يُقَلِّبُ بَصَرَهُ فِينَا حَتَّى رَأَى أَبَا عُبَيْدَ عَامِرِ بْنِ جَرَّاحِ فَدَعَاهُ. So he continued to look till he spotted Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah. So he called him to come forward. And here Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Christian delegation was sitting in the masjid. He told Abu Ubaida, اخرج معهم فقضي بينهم بالحق. Go out with them and listen to both parties and judge them with truth and justice. And Umar ibn Khattab, he said, ذهب بها أبو عبيدة. I lost that medal. Abu Ubaida got the title of Al-Qawi Al-Amin. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed in the year 11, and whom to be his successor was an issue happened in what we call Saqifat Bani Sa'id. And here, Umar ibn al-Khattab with the Muhajireen reminded their brothers from Ansar that in many occasions, and it's apparently for that generation, not all the way to the Day of Judgment, that Quraysh, from Quraysh al-Umara, because Arabia would listen to somebody from Mecca while they wouldn't listen to somebody from other areas. And al-Wuzara from Ansar. And the Ansar agreed for this argument after initial dispute and led by Sa'd ibn Ubadah. And here Umar ibn al-Khattab was very instrumental in securing the position as a leader or successor to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by nominating Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah. And here Abu Ubaida, and he cited that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna li kulli ummatin amina, wa anta aminu hadhihi al-umma." That Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, for every ummah has a trustee or an ameen or guardian for the faith, and you are the ameen. So you should be the khalifa. But here Abu Ubaida stood up and he said, ما كنت لأتقدم بين يدي رجل أمره رسول الله يوم صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يأمنا في الصلاة فأمنا حتى مات. Abu Ubaida رضي الله عنه said, I would not be in the front as an imam and a leader where there is one person who was asked by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be the imam and the leader of the salah till he died, meaning Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So this scenario happened where everyone came to his senses that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was the shadow of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From day number one, his contribution to Islam was unparalleled by anyone, and he dedicated all his life. He led the salah for several nights on an order from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before he died. So here we know that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was nominated and was elected to be the Khalifa of the Muslimin. We're mentioning this to tell you about the caliber of Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah. He was in a position to be elected to be Khalifa. As a matter of fact, Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he died, after he was stabbed and killed by Abu Lu'lu'a al-Majusi, al-Farisi, he said, he lived 3 days after that or died from the wounds. If Abu Ubaida was alive, and we know Abu Ubaida died in the year 18 of the Hijrah, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anh died in the year 23. So when he was dying, he said, if Abu Ubaida was alive, I would not hesitate to nominate him to be Khalifa. So Abu Ubaida was the same caliber of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Umar ibn al-Khattab, Uthman ibn Affan, Ali ibn Abi Talib. And we know that he is in the same club of Al-Ashar al-Mubashareen bil-Jannah. Abu Bakr Siddiq was very mild mannered, very soft, very gentle, except when it comes to the haqq and to the rules of law, he became a giant, as we know from Hurub al-Ridda. He appointed a strong leader, a strong general, let's call him, and that is Khalid ibn al-Walid. Khalid ibn al-Walid was very strong, very person and personality, similar to the personality of Umar ibn al-Khattab. As a matter of fact, not too many of us know that they are cousins, mother side. The mother of Umar ibn al-Khattab and the mother of Khalid ibn al-Walid are sisters. So they are cousins from the mother side. And they were look alike in their physique. Both of them were very tall, like 6'8". And both of them had the same strength and power and personality. And here when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, in his 2 years term, till he died, he used Khalid ibn al-Walid as his defense minister. We see when Umar ibn al-Khattab became Khalifa, and Umar ibn al-Khattab in his personality was quite opposite to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. He was strong and he placed his opposite to be the leader of the armies and the general. So he hired Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah to be. So here you have two personalities, strong, or let's call hawkish and dove. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq used Khalid ibn al-Walid to match his personality and so on. We know that because after Umar came to the Khilafah, he asked Khalid ibn al-Walid to step down from the leadership of the whole armies. And we know he assigned Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah. And of course, he made it very clear to every part of the Muslim Ummah that this decision based not on like or dislike or based on any other thing except the well-being of the Muslims and the whole Ummah. Because at that time, the people were fascinated with the victories of Khalid ibn al-Walid. And the people started putting their trust in Khalid ibn al-Walid. And they wanted to be in the army of Khalid ibn al-Walid. So it became like he is a symbol of victory. And we know that this is something contrary to our teaching, that the Nasr come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the people won't be fascinated with Khalid ibn al-Walid. He was removed from the leadership of the armies. And he continued to be as a soldier under Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah, who did the same thing and achieved the same victories. And this is another lesson we have to understand, that the victory comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when the people meet the criteria, okay, of taqwa and to be righteous and so on. In the year of 16 to 18, there was an epidemic of a disease, plague, spread in Palestine and killed tens of thousands of people. And of the Muslims, the historians, they tell us that 25,000 of Muslims perished from that plague. And it is called Ta'un Amwas, the city which received the most hit in Palestine, called Amwas. We know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, if there is a epidemic, a disease in an area, don't go there. And if you are in an area where the disease is spread, don't go out. So this is the basic principle for the current quarantine. Umar ibn al-Khattab was going to Palestine to meet Abu Ubaida, and the news came that there was an epidemic there of disease, and he decided to go back. And some of the Muslims argued, how come? You know, قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا. That's true. But again, here Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf came and he cited this hadith from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If there is a disease in an area where there is a waba, there is an epidemic of infectious disease, don't go there. And if you are there, don't go out. And here Umar ibn al-Khattab was very happy to hear that citation of the hadith. And Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah, before the disease spread, Umar in Al-Madinah heard the news, and he tried to summon Abu Ubaida to save him that fate. But Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah understood Umar, and he told him, no, I'm not going to leave my soldiers, and I will receive the same fate they received. So he, this is the only time, and he asked him forgiveness for not obeying him. This time only he did not obey the orders, and he asked him to release him from that demand, and Umar ibn al-Khattab did that, and he cried. He cried very hardly, and the companions around him said, what happened? Did Abu Ubaida die? Umar ibn al-Khattab said, no, he did not die yet, but the death is very close to him. And the first visit of Umar ibn al-Khattab to Jerusalem, and Abu Ubaida was in charge, Umar ibn al-Khattab, as a khalifa, he does not save anyone of his inspection or his, you know, scrutiny. So when he saw the life of Abu Ubaida in the tent has nothing and so on, he told him, غَيَّرَتْنَا الدُّنْيَا مِنْ بَعْدِكَ يَا أَبَا عُبَيْدَ. Yet we have changed, you have not changed from the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he slept in the tent of Abu Ubaida, and they reminisced about their days when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was among them. And both of them started crying or weeping. And they turned in the tent, there was two beds. They turned their faces to the tents and their backs to each other and continued to cry till the Fajr prayer. They were reminiscing the good old days with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We know that when Abu Ubaida died, he was like close to 60, 58 years of age. And he assigned, before his death, assigned Mu'adh ibn Jabal to make Salatul Janazah. And we know that many great companions lost their life in that epidemic, including Shurahbil ibn Hasana al-Iyadi and Al-Fadl ibn al-Abbas, and Mu'adh ibn Jabal, and Abu Ubaida Amr ibn al-Jarrah, and many other great companions, they passed in the epidemic of Ta'un Amwas in the year 18. And if you go back to the books of which is a specialist in the life of the companions, especially the companions who are in the caliber of Abu Ubaida Amr ibn al-Jarrah, you find details about their lives and their correspondence, their letters. It tells you about great personalities, virtuous people, achieved the highest level of performing or living the moral values. And the principles of humanity and love and compassion I encourage all of you to go to those books and read them in details. They are very touchy, and you can learn a lot from them. May Allah have his mercy and blessing on Abu Ubaida Amr ibn Jarrah Alfihri and the rest of the companions. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.